First, I just want to define violence. Let's whip out a dictionary here. One, swift and intense force, the violence of a storm. The example there is not really relevant because I'm referring to human-generated violence, but anyway. Number two, rough or injurious physical force, action, or treatment, to die by violence. Three, an unjust or unwarranted exertion of power or force as against rights or laws, to take over a government by violence. I'm personally in disagreement with the word laws being included there because not all laws are just, and I think the first part of the sentence stands better on its own. But fine. Number four, a violent act or proceeding. And number five, rough or immoderate vehemence as of feeling or language, the violence of his hatred. There's a sixth one too, but it's not really relevant either. It has to do with violently editing text. I just kind of wanted to say that I'm talking about violence in an all-encompassing way, not just physical violence, but emotional, social, and psychological violence as well. Violence is a tragedy that occurs only in response to another tragedy. It can be taken in one form and given back out in another, in a self-perpetuating, self-feeding cycle. And when taking a closer look, we see that the division between victim and perpetrator begins to blur and moral judgments become obsolete, viewing the event as tragic from all sides.
Help, I have done it again. I have been. Hurt myself again today, and the worst part is there's no one else to blame. Be my friend.
Psyche needs love in order to survive, just as specifically as the body needs oxygen in order to survive. And for people who haven't been starved for love, that may not be the first thing they would think of. I mean, we kind of take it for granted that we get love from a lot of people. But if you have lived in an environment where you were starved for that, you're talking about a different, whole different range of experience. Just like with somebody who's starved for oxygen. I mean, most of the time we don't even think about the air we breathe, it's just the air we breathe. But when somebody's oxygen supply is cut off, you realize it's life-threatening in a very short time. Well, the same with the prisoners. They were like people whose oxygen supply had been cut off, but it was their love supply. And I realized that without love, the soul cannot survive. It dies. And that's what these men were telling me. Their souls had died. That's why they were capable of killing other people. I have seen the most violent people we have. And when I first started out with many of them, I thought they were hopeless. I thought there was nothing we could do. They were untreatable, incurable. What I discovered is I was wrong. I've known some of these men for 25 or 30 years now. People who were off the scale, who were mute, paranoid, multiple murderers, who'd been killing people even after they got into prison or jail. We were able to work with and turn around so that they haven't harmed a hair on anybody's head, you know, for the last 25 years. And in fact are engaged in constructive work. In the case of the extremes, like I just mentioned, still in a correctional institution, but in other words, not harming anybody and not harming himself, even after he had a history of killing people within the jail. So what I'm saying is you can take the most hopeless cases, and my The recommendation is don't give up on anybody. There is no human being who cannot be reached at some level or another if you have the dedication and the patience and you're willing to think of it as something that has to go on sometimes not just for months or years, but for decades. Human beings can be, even dead souls can be resurrected. And we can learn something from that. We're not just doing this to be good Samaritans to, you know, these poor murderers. We are doing it also because it helps the entire human race. It helps all of us if we can learn what causes violence and how we can prevent it. And we can only learn it, I think, ultimately, from the most violent people.
The way to do that is to reach what the strengths are and what the goodness is inside about everybody in the prison system. If we don't do that, we know they will go out and harm people again. So if you could just create an environment of healing, an environment that allows this goodness to ripple back up, I think the sky's the limit. And I think the public could save a great deal of money, and really we could create a lot better society, a much more humane prison and much more effective prison.
So while there are people who realize this working within the prison industry, popular opinion is often that we should be tougher on crime, offer harsher punishments, create more laws, more security, and while we're at it, offer the prisoners less and less and worse conditions to, you know, save costs, since they're just criminals anyway. And so true change is ubiquitously blocked or slowed by outdated, societally perpetuated values. Love-starved people do not need less love, they need more. And while not everyone reaches the point of murder or soul death, as James Gilligan poetically stated, people who would seek to destroy another's life, health, or happiness, people who get angry easily or lash out in ways exceeding what is called for in the scenario, as well as people who would seek violent retribution against these people, all have one thing in common. They are acting on unconscious, love-starved modes of thought.
Now, the usual approach in North America is a behavioral one. So, for example, a kid acts out, then we punish him. That's the usual approach. If they act out, we punish him. We punish him with timeouts, or with tough love, or logical consequences, or something. For most of you, if you're trained in this culture, when I say that a kid is acting out, you'll see that kid being rude. It doesn't mean bad behavior. It has a very specific meaning. When you act out, you're portraying in behavior something you haven't got the language to say in words. So in a game of charades, you have to act out because you're not permitted to use words. Consider the possibility that our children's behavior, their so-called oppositionality, their rudeness, their difficulty learning from negative experience, their bullying, their precocious sexuality, all the stuff that they do isn't acting out. In other words, they're portraying something in behavior they haven't got the language for.
Now, obviously this is not either a conscious process or a voluntary one. I'm talking about automatic survival mechanisms that the human psyche engages in order to survive, levels of trauma that would just obliterate the self immediately. I mean, people, they couldn't function. And I would say the deepest fear that human beings have, as I've seen it, as I've observed it over the years, is the fear of the disintegration of the self.
So our job is to understand what is being acted out and to respond to the message, not to try and suppress the message, but to respond to it creatively. But the behavioral approach doesn't let you do that. The behavioral approach just says stop this behavior by any way you can. So you reward the good behavior or you punish the bad.
The assumption here is when somebody's done something bad, the only way we can teach him not to keep doing that bad thing is to punish him, and that will teach him. The fact is, we have abundant evidence showing that punishment does not inhibit or prevent violence. On the contrary, punishment is the most powerful stimulant of violence we've discovered yet. But I'm making a very important distinction here between punishment and restraint. As I've already said, I do believe we need to restrain people who are dangerous to others by isolating them in a locked, secure facility but not isolating them in another sense, because we would want them to have full access to educational and therapeutic personnel. I would, of course, invite the families and the wives and girlfriends to come in for conjugal visits, for family visits. I would try to give these men every possible chance to maintain familial ties as long as they were behaving constructively toward the members of their family.
This imagined need or benefit from punishment permeates our entire culture. And now you might be saying, come on, really? All we need is love. Okay, so obviously it's not that simple. And besides, punishment is necessary, isn't it, to teach people lessons on how to behave properly? What kind of lessons are we teaching people when we punish? It's a game that we like. We crave. When we yell at a child, we are teaching them that yelling at people to get what they want is okay. When we send them to their room, we teach them that trying to control the behavior of others is okay. When we hit them, we are saying that hitting people to get what you want is okay. When we publicly condone police tasering, using firearms, and beating the shit out of misbehaving citizens, we send the message that physically harming people is a culturally and socially acceptable way to get a desired result. By torturing, caging, and sometimes even killing violent humans, we're saying that sometimes these things are okay. We use what basically amounts to social, psychological, and physical terrorism on ourselves, our neighbors, and our children, and we expect things to get better. We as a society cannot correct dysfunctional behavior from our participant members if we are engaging in or regularly and tacitly consenting to similar dysfunctional behavior on a social level. Doing this has only exacerbated the behaviors and creates a double standard. Socially acceptable forms of violence, from corporate-induced poverty to the death penalty or imprisonment, simply cannot be separated at a fundamental level from what we today call criminal violence. They share a common core: feelings of being wronged, ignored, or not good enough, and the search for justice. Everybody is a victim of violence to some degree or another, so how can we stop violence if it can simply be passed around from person to person ad nauseum? It's a tough question, but I think by simply realizing this fact, we can consciously minimize the output of our own violent tendencies. And secondly, we can start taking into account the reality that much violence isn't perpetuated person to person directly, but by institutions, governments, corporations, and the like.
The main social and economic causes of violence, and I'll add political causes, are those that divide the population into the superior and the inferior, the strong and the weak, the rich and the poor. The more highly unequal a society is, the higher its rates of violence. For example, the most powerful predictor of homicide rates throughout the world, and this has been repeated in dozens of studies, is the size of the gap between the rich and the poor. The greater the degree of economic inequality in a society, the higher the murder rate.
Economic inequality, social stratification, I mean, that's the basis of our entire individualistic, self-maximizing, free market society.
Wait. Are you saying that pitting people against each other in a big free-for-all competition isn't the most effective way to run society?
In a market system, its very structure makes inequality unavoidable. There must be winners and losers, and this creates feelings of shame and inferiority. It is just another form of violence, and when we look at the stress, pain, and millions of deaths caused by this violent global inequality, we see that it is at the fundamental level of almost every type of social stressor. I think there might even be some organization or social change direction out there that realizes these exact problems and has this scientifically based solution that could replace market economics and reduce this type of social stress. Anyway, back to what can I do? Well, all I can say is this type of change has to start with us, with me, with you. We are society, we are creating culture. Just as the values of violence self-perpetuate, so can the values of nonviolence, understanding, acceptance, and the absence of moral discrimination, because even if violence might seem justified, that is just a moral perspective, and justifying violence simply leads to more violence down the road. The only way to ensure violence does not happen is to end its perpetuation in all forms.
Jay, we're here in Cleveland, Ohio. You're homeless.
Yes, sir.
If you had three wishes, what would they be?
If I had three wishes, I believe first I would wish that everyone would treat everyone as equals. We're all the same, we're all human beings. Why can't we just help each other? That would be my first wish. And I think if everyone did that, I might not even need two more wishes.
Don't give up on anybody. There is no human being who cannot be reached at some level or another.